Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our service today, and welcome, welcome all who have joined us. I hope that you're having the most blessed day, and I pray that your day and week to come are going to be doubly blessed with a double portion given to you by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who we've come to praise and worship today. Grace and peace be unto you in the name of our Lord Jesus. And my name is Pastor Brian Comiskey. I'm leading us in service today, and I welcome you once again. It's been an incredible start of our Lenten season, and it's been a wonderful, just a reverent, I should say, day. Ash Wednesday was just so full of blessings for myself when I got to see all you wonderful people that have come to our churches to receive the ashes and to, metaphorically speaking, lay down and fall down in front of our Lord at His feet and worship Him and repent and just remember that we are dust. From dust we came, to dust we shall return. And it is through the power and strength and life source of our Lord that we are even able to exist and have a life, much less a life of goodness and graciousness and full of blessings. So anyway, we give you thanks for being here, and thank you for all who have come out, and thank you, by the way, for all the birthday wishes. Today is my birthday, and well, that I'm recording it today is my birthday, so thank you for all the birthday wishes, and I give you thanks for all the wonderful blessings and gifts and the reaching out with all the messages of appreciation. I just really do thank you. So anyway, let's get to our service, shall we? Let's go. We're here to worship the Lord, so let's go and do that. We'll start with our centering words. God is faithful, merciful, and full of steadfast love. God remembers creation and the everlasting covenant of forgiveness. God has come in Jesus Christ, beloved Son and Savior of the world. Come back to God, for it is only here that we find true hope, true life, and true joy. Well, amen to that. Let's go to our call to worship, and if you'll join me in our call to worship, I'd appreciate it. Here we go. We trust in you, O God, for you are faithful. Show us your ways and teach us your paths. We wait for you. Lead us in your paths of truth. Do not remember our failures. Out of your merciful grace, forgive us. You are faithful, O God. Your love is steadfast. We lift up our souls to you and praise you always. Absolutely. Amen to that. So if you'll join me in our opening prayer, let's pray out together. Whoops. I get that over here for you. Let us pray. God of the covenant, you are ever faithful. Your love never ends. Teach us your ways and guide us in your paths of love and forgiveness, that we may witness to your grace and salvation. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let's go to the Lord in song and sing out this morning for our opening hymn. And it is a wonderful opening hymn that's full of the Spirit. So let's sing out together, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Well, let's go to our first scripture reading. Our first scripture reading is from Mark. And it is, Mark 1, verses 9 through 15. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. Jesus announces the good news after John was put in prison. Well, Jesus went into Galilee. That was a heading. Excuse me. Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. "And the time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." Amen. Amen to that. Well, here ends our first scripture reading. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, I wanted to tell you really quick about a woman. Her name was Mrs. Gladys Dunn, and she was a pillar in her church. And she visited the sick, and she greeted newcomers. You know this kind of person, right? We all have one in our church. She served on every committee and substituted for the organist when it was necessary. And after the services one day, she noticed a stranger leaving the church. And so she hurried over and went up to introduce herself and extended her hand and said, "I'm Gladys Dunn." And the stranger replied, "Me too. That was the longest sermon I've ever heard." So, if you're sitting out there wondering what's wrong with this guy, yep, keep wondering now. Well, actually, if you're sitting out there and I think about whenever I'm giving a service and people yawn, you know, all the time. And if you're in my church service and I see you yawn, don't worry, I'm not taking it that you're bored or anything like that. I understand you're tired. You know, it's been a long week and that was quite a party you attended last night. But I'm joking about that because on that note, in many churches long ago, and maybe possibly today, I'm not sure exactly, but there was a position called church warden. If anybody's ever heard of a church warden, and it's not a joke, it's true. They had no real legal power out in the street, in the world, but on church property, they actually had the authority to arrest people. And they upheld the unspoken laws of the church. If people were rowdy, you know, they'd kick them out. I guess they were kind of like church bouncers is what they really were. They'd protect the church properties and many other duties. And now I don't know a lot about it because I've just recently found out about this. But if you go to some of the older churches in our country, you can see tools used by the church warden. And for a good example is if you've ever been to the old North Church in Boston. Of course, that's the church back in 1775. They were to hang a lamp in the steeple. When they saw the British coming, and one lamp if by land and two if by sea. Well, anyway, if you visit this old North Church today and you enter from the back, you can see next to the first pews two long white poles standing up, one on each side. And if you get a chance to Google it, you can see, you know, you'll see them. They're right there. And on the tall tip of each of these poles is a wooden pine cone shaped point. And apparently they're called warden wands, these poles. And the warden wands had different uses, like if there was a group of unruly people and had to be moved out the door, they would use these poles to prod them along. Or it was used as a means to protect the priest if that's necessary. But one of them was if someone nodded off during a sermon, the church warden would take it and poke at them and wake them up. And this is true. So I thought, well, maybe I should get a couple of those with for our church, but anyway, probably not. Yeah, I just got a kick out of that. It's just that picture in my mind of poking people. Hey, wake up. Well, justice to those who dare to sleep in church, right? And, you know, we actually are talking about justice today. Justice is something that is mentioned often in the Bible, right? And to be honest, I really didn't know what I was getting into. If I had thought about it, I would have given myself a few weeks to write this message. Because it seems like a simple concept, you know. Justice, in its simplest definition, means to make right. And biblical justice, though, means something more. It means to conduct your business and your ministry, your very lives, in a way that recognizes equality for everyone, to live in a manner that is just, to show mercy and seek righteousness. And there's a lot of scriptures that talk about justice in the Bible, right? And there are different kinds of justice that we find in there. Of the most well-known is retributive justice. We find mostly in the Old Testament with people getting punished for their wrongdoings by God or what have you. And there's social justice, the fair treatment and opportunities for all members of society. There's distributive justice, the fair distribution of resources and opportunities. And I think mostly we're going to focus today on restorative justice, which focuses on making amends and restoring relationships between individuals. Now, this last one includes the restoring of the most important relationship of all, which is between us humans and God, which is what happened when Jesus came to earth and saved us and went through his life and died on the cross and rose again. That was a restoring relationship. That was restorative justice. And, you know, I don't know if you noticed, but in our scripture today that we, well, what we just read there from Mark, it didn't mention the word justice. And you'll see coming up in the psalm we're going to read in a little while that it did not come up there at all, the word justice, not once. But the reason we're talking about it is because, again, something prompted me when you read this Psalm 25 coming up in verse 10. What it says is, all the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful toward those who keep the demands of his covenant. And I looked at that, and with that in mind, I went and read these passages from Mark in light of that statement, and it reads, you know, like we just read, when Jesus was baptized by John, he took his head and dunked it and pulled him out of the water. And when Jesus started coming up out of the water, he perceived the heavens opening up and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And a voice from heaven was heard, "You are my Son, who I love. With you I am well pleased." And then it says the Spirit led him out to the wilderness for 40 days and was tempted by Satan. And after that it says John was put into prison. And Jesus began to preach the good news. Repent, the kingdom of God is near. Now, the first connection I get between these two scriptures begins in the psalm, and it talks about the covenant, those who keep the demands of his covenant. And what are the demands of his covenant? When Jesus came into this world, he made a new covenant with us, a covenant of water and the Spirit. And in Mark, it talks about Jesus coming up out of the water and his baptism, right? And the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And so this connection exists between these two pieces of scripture from the Old and the New Testament. But after connection, another connection with the idea that this Psalm 25 was written, it was written by David. I have to remember that this was long before, of course, Jesus. And we know David's writings are very prophetic about the coming of the Messiah, the coming of Jesus. And when he wrote those words, on a surface level, he was referring to the covenant of Moses that was in existence. Now, on the prophetic level, that's a whole different ballgame, because Jesus didn't really keep the commands of the Mosaic covenant too well, did he? We know he broke the rules all the time, from allowing his disciples to pick grain while walking to the field on the Sabbath. He himself healed on the Sabbath, blaspheming in the eyes of the scribes and Pharisees by daring to say, "Before Abraham was, I am." We weren't allowed to do that. But again, this Jesus, when he came to earth, created a new covenant. And what was this covenant? Well, let's ask first, what was the old covenant between God and Moses and the children of Israel? It was all about following the laws. And it was strict, and it was precise and unyielding, and it was exactly, you know, what the people needed at the time back then. They needed to be told, you need to do this, and you need to do this, and this, and this, and you need to do it like this. That's what they needed at the time. by the time Jesus came, the law had been corrupted by the religious leaders and was being used by them to hoard their power over the people. In other words, there was no justice for the common people. So when Jesus came, a new covenant was established, and it is a covenant of grace. When Jesus came, he not only astounded the people with his miracles and associating with untouchables, and he also astounded them with his commands. What's this new covenant about? He said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." In other words, it's not outside of your reach. This was radical teachings. I mean, it was always out of the hands of the people. It was only through the religious leaders. But now Jesus is saying that the kingdom is here with you. You are accessible to it. He commanded, do not resist an evil person. If anybody slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. He said, if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand your coat over as well. Said, do not judge or you too will be judged. Forgive, not 7 times, but 7 times 70. And of course, the greatest commandment, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself, which wasn't new. He was just reminding them. And you know, the list will go on and on. But it was dramatically different than what the laws of Moses stated. An eye for an eye was replaced by love your enemy. Very, very different. Jesus said, cast your burden upon me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And yet, there is still justice for those who don't follow the commands of Jesus. Those who remain stubborn and hard-hearted, that still is something that existed. And a good example were the religious leaders of the time. They themselves witnessed some of the miracles that Jesus performed. They saw him heal that man with the shriveled arm right in front of their faces. And what did they say? Wow, that's amazing. Oh my God, God is good. No, they said, you know, you're not supposed to heal on the Sabbath. What? What's wrong with you? But Jesus said, my yoke is easy. So it may be light compared to the burden of the older laws, but there is still work we need to do. There are commands given to us by Jesus to follow. You see, when a new covenant was established by Jesus and he was crucified and died and rose again, yes, that covered our sins. Yes, God's love is beyond measure, and God's grace continuously upholds us and sustains us every day. But there's this situation that we find ourselves in where we can't stay in this world forever, and there's this place called heaven, and there's this thing called eternal bliss, and what we do on this earth and how we live and the loves that we grow into have a lot to do with whether or not we get into heaven, into this heaven or not. There's some religions that believe that what Jesus did, it is finished, it is done, and that's true. But that it covers your salvation, yes. But to think that you don't have to worry anymore about anything, no matter what you do, you know, Jesus paid the price and everyone will eventually go to heaven, that's not how it works. That's putting the blame of God for sending people to hell. There's a story of a man who went to his pastor. I want to share this really quick. He was thinking about this life and he was thinking about the next life, and he wanted to confirm that his lifestyle was acceptable in the eyes of God. Because he felt like, you know, I think I'm in a pretty good spiritual place. I think I'm on the right track for heaven. And so he went to his priest because he wanted to justify himself, really. And he went to the priest. He said, I just want to talk to you about my life and make sure I'm on the right track. And so he talked to the priest about his life, his work, his family, his extracurricular activities. And he said, You know, Pastor, you know I come to church every Sunday. So I'm doing okay, right? And the pastor says, or the priest, he says, well, that sounds pretty good. But let me ask you. You've been coming to church here for a while now, like you said, I see that. And I know you're a business owner and you're doing very well. You talk about your 3 homes and your boat and everything, and that's fine. But how are your employees?
How do you take care of those? Are they paid well enough? Do they have the right kind of benefits? In other words, are they able to sustain their family and keep off assistance? And well, the man kind of squirmed a little bit and said, well, I guess some of them are on assistance, but you know, they need to also make good choices with their money. Okay, said the priest, well, you know, what about that situation you talked to me about, you know, last year, and you were arrested for fighting at that pub, and the court said you could stay your sentence if you got counseling about your anger issues. So, if you don't mind me asking, are you still getting counseling? Oh, no, he said, yeah, I just went a couple times. They didn't really, like, do anything. My lawyer actually got me out of that. I'm fine. Uh-huh. Well, anything else? You know, I know some people get caught up in pornography. Any issues with that? Oh, he goes, well, you know, I look at a couple of girly pictures here and there, and, you know, I'm not addicted to that or anything. That's just a guy thing. Most guys do that, so. Okay, so the priest says, so what I hear you're saying is that you have an issue with greed, anger, and lust. And you think you're fit for heaven. You believe that you're on the right track for heaven? Listen, my friend, you have some work to do. You know, we have the grace of God. But the truth is, we don't have a free pass into heaven. We need to be aware of our spiritual lives and watch our attitudes about it. Once when somebody asked Jesus, good teacher, what must I do to gain eternal life? If you know this story, he said, first of all, don't call me good. There's only one good, and then, which is God. And then he listed about six different commandments. And on the Sermon on the Mount, he actually talks about some of the commandments. But what he said was, I have not come to destroy the commandments, the prophets, but to fulfill them. He came bringing depth to them. And we're not to murder, yes, but on a deeper level. We're not to go around feeling murderous thoughts about other people, right? Jesus tells us that's just as bad. So what do we do? How do we live knowing God's grace is infinite, yet we are called to live in a way that is keeping with the Lord's commandments, knowing we're not perfect? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, therefore be perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect, knowing full well that nobody was going to be perfect as God is. It is the highest standard which Jesus wants us to aspire to. But the word Jesus used for perfection, actually, that the people would have read in other places of the Hebrew Bible, is not used to mean flawless behavior. It's actually rather a life of complete loyalty to Jehovah in spite of temptation and setbacks. We are called to remain loyal, to keep the commands before us. And when we have setbacks, we humble ourselves and we keep our focus on God. If we think about it, God's justice is something that we've created because there's not a flaw in God, only in mankind. And if everyone in the world stopped sinning, there would be no need for justice. And what we think would be justice from God is really only love. Love, pure love. In Amos 5:24, it says, let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. And that is how God's justice is, continuous, deep, and strong. A good way to think of it is, and I'll finish with this, a good way to think of it is like an airplane flying from point A to point B. The course is straight and flawless, and that is God. But when a human flies a plane and you took a photo of the flight path that it took, it's rarely on course. It's constantly correcting itself back and forth. And there's weather that happens. And if there's serious trouble, the crew on the ground, like God, will never give up trying to save you. And because of God's nature to love us, God will never compel us or force us to do the right things. That stubbornness that people can have to not listen to the Lord's instructions will sadly cause some to crash and burn. But when we are doing our best to stay on course, we will reach our destination. And even despite our flaws, when we stand before God, God will say, "You are my daughter. You are my son, who I love. And with you, I am well pleased." Amen. Dear friends, let's go to the Lord in song. We'll sing it out this morning, and we'll have the Spirit song be our second hymn today. If you're reading the hymnal, it's 347. Let's sing out to the Lord this morning. Excellent singing, everybody. Well, let's move on with our second scripture reading. And it is, again, Psalm 25. So here we go, 1 through 10. In you, Lord, my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame. But shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful toward those who keep the demands of his covenant. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. My friends, as we get into our prayer time, let us go and think of those who are hurting today. Think of those who are needing prayer. Think of those who are suffering from natural disasters and the loss of loved ones in those ways, and any other way of when we lose our loved ones, no matter what the circumstance, it's never easy, of course. We all experience that, of course, at some point of our lives. So keep in prayer those who are hurting in that way. Keep in prayer those who are of course, overseas, and families that are affected here in our country, those in the military that are starting to receive calls to arms in sort of way. They're starting to be called from home. The reserve people are starting to be on alert and stuff like that. So it's a stressful time for many people, for all of us. And again, we've got a lot of unrest in our country. You know, there's the people who were involved in the shooting with the Super Bowl parade, and those who have died and those who are suffering and from the injuries, and those who whatever causes them to do such damage. We pray for those. We are called to pray for our enemy, like we talked about. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning and lift up those thoughts that we have. Not only for those we're in prayer for, but also if we want to bask in the allness and unflawedness of the Lord. Let's take a moment of silence. Eternal God, you created us in your own image and likeness, but sin, selfishness has warped the minds of your people, and throughout the world there's so much injustice and much carelessness of the rights of other people and personal responsibilities and just carelessness about your word, Lord. When we are excluded from our hearts and consciousness, the inevitable results, we suffer. And our suffering is our own fault. Lord, there's much of that injustice and corruption taking place in our world today. So we pray that you will guide us to right all the wrongs that are taking place in our world and vindicate those that are being treated unjustly. Lord, keep us from trying to take matters into our own hands for vengeance and retribution. We pray to you, Lord, and your grace and mercy that you would give justice and peace to all those that have been cruelly and unfairly treated by their fellow man. And may this carelessness that they have had to endure be the means to draw them into your saving arms of grace. If nothing else, Lord, let something good come out of it, as we know that you can turn all to your good. Lord, we pray for those who are battling with pain and disease, for those who are struggling with emotional issues, and for those that are lost spiritually. Help them to find you. If there's anything that we need to do, Lord, please enable our hearts to engage. Lord, we pray for our schools and our children. Watch over them, protect them. We pray for our communities that we might not be so divided. Help us to come together in grace and understanding. We pray for our country, that your those God-given freedoms, Lord, that may be protected. And Lord, we pray for our world that we might somehow live in peace. For nothing is impossible with you, Lord. We pray this today with a prayer that you taught us those many years ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you for praying together, and we do recognize those who have given to our churches and all of our ministries. We thank you, and we continue to give thanks and continue to reach out as often, and we turn to God for these offerings, that He may take them and grow them, use them to grow the ministries of the kingdom. And so we'll continue to pray for inspiration to guide us in the ways that we use the gifts that we are given, and so continue to do so. Well, let's sing out today over the we'll sing out over the offering right now.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
Well, dear friends, again, let's go to our singing, our closing hymn, which is Majesty, Worship His Majesty, one of my favorite hymns, number 176. Let's sing out to the Lord together. Amen.
worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Well, excellent singing, everybody. Well done. And my friends, once again, what can I say except for you are just a joy to have here with us worshiping. We're so thankful for you to be here. We look forward to seeing you come back next week. Send this link out to other people if you feel like it's something that they might need or want to hear or whatever. We look forward to hopefully seeing you soon at some point, and we look forward to also being able to serve you in any way that we can. If you have any special prayers, put them in the link below, in the comments rather. But again, God bless y'all. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen. Amen. Wonderful to worship with you again. I hope you have the most blessed day, and we look forward to seeing you soon. God bless you all. Take care now. Bye-bye.